Hey guys, Brother John checking in for our Wednesday in the Word, and today we're going to wrap up Romans chapter 8. I hope you guys have enjoyed it as much as I have going through this. We're going to continue to do Wednesdays in the Word. I think I know where I'm going next. We'll decide when we get there, but I'll just tell you, I think we're going to go through John chapter 3 starting next week. And so, but anyway, we're wrapping up Romans 8 today. We're going to be in verses 31 through 39. And let's just remind ourselves real quick of what we've seen and how we've divided this up. We've gone through, really, we have a, can you, as soon as I started this, my face started itching, right? And so y'all don't tell the CDC that I just scratched my lip. I just touched my face. Don't worry, I have washed my hands, so don't report me. That would be bad. The first thing we looked at was Romans 8, 1 through 4, where we saw that since we have been freed from sin and indwelt by the Spirit, we can walk according to the Spirit and not the flesh. And then we moved on to Romans 8, 5 through 8, where we saw that if our minds are set on the things of the Spirit, then we're able to please God. And then we looked at Romans 8, 9 through 11. Then we saw that though our bodies are now dead, they will be made alive if the Spirit lives in us. So we talked about completed salvation. Then we looked at Romans 8, 12 through 17, where we saw that since we are His children, then we must actively seek personal holiness. In other words, living out our faith. And then we got to Romans 8, 18 through 25, where we saw that our hope is in completed salvation. And then just two verses, Romans 8, 26 and 27, that even though we often don't know how or what to pray, the Holy Spirit prays for us. And that theme comes up again in our verses today, but it's not the Holy Spirit that prays in this instance. We're going to see that Jesus also prays for us. And then last week, we just looked at three verses, Romans 8, 28 through 30, most likely the most famous verses in this chapter. And we saw that if we know God, then He uses our circumstances for good. So we've been going, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So seven different sections in Romans 8. So the eighth and final one is today. And it's the most lengthy that we've looked at. Let me read it. Romans 8, 31 through 39. Paul writes, "What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him over for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? Who will bring a charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is He who died, yes, rather who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? Just as it is written, for your sake we are being put to death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. But in all these things we overwhelmingly conquer through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord." And so Paul really, there I am scratching my face again. Y'all notice I lost 5 pounds since last week. Yeah, I got my hair cut last night. It was terrible. You know, I can see now they found all this gray in it that had been, no, it had really, you know, I think they put like gray dye in the scissors because every time I get my hair cut, it just seems to get grayer and grayer. But it was nice to get all that stuff chopped off last week. I was starting to look kind of like a hippie or a beatnik or, you know, what's that guy, the dude that played Gilligan on Gilligan's Island? What was this character, Maynard Krebs, in the previous show? I was starting to feel like Maynard or Shaggy on Scooby-Doo. But anyway, This last section of Romans 8, Paul really, he's been giving us theology. He's been being pretty controlled, and then he just sort of breaks out into preaching when you get to these last verses. So let's walk through them and see what we see. There in verse 31 that I just read, he says, "What then shall we say to these things?" Well, these things are everything he said, really the entire book up to this point, but particularly starting in chapter 8 and verse 1, where he starts out, "Therefore there is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus." And then he just you know, launches from there into this great, you know, theological treatise. And he says, so what do we say to these things? In other words, how do we respond? If God is for us, who's against us? And we know the answer to that is, well, no one. Ultimately, God is all powerful. He's in charge of all things. And so if God's on our side, nobody's gonna have victory over him. So he talks about where that comes from and about the nature of God. In verse 32, he says, "He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him over for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things?" So he starts to talk about the fact that God in his grace and in his mercy sent Jesus to come and to die for us. And it shows us that God is a loving God, that he is a giving God. And he says it in an interesting way. He says, "Will freely give us all things." That's grace. That's mercy. That's getting something that we didn't deserve. And that's the nature of God. That's what he does. That's what the gospel is the fact that God loved us so much that he sent his son to die for us. We didn't deserve that. We were born sinful and continued a life of sinful separation from God. And only because the Lord loved us, he sent Jesus to come and to die so that we may know him. And Paul is talking about the fact that once we respond to that grace and mercy by repenting of our sins and placing our faith in Jesus Christ, that our salvation is absolutely rock solid, secured. So let's keep going. In verse 33, he asks an interesting question. He says, "Who will bring a charge against God's elect?" That word charge is interesting because it's used several times in the book of Acts to talk about legal charges brought against Paul. So this is a personal word for him. This is a word that he understands, that he understands the implications of. And he says, who's going to bring a charge against God's elect, against God's chosen? That word elect is, I know it can be a scary word, but it's very much written from God's perspective. Remember, God exists outside of time, and that word elect is used by Jesus, it's used by Paul, it's used by Peter to describe God's people. And so as Paul is talking about us, as he's talking about our relationship with him and how God is in control of all things, he brings this idea that nobody can bring a charge against those who have repented of their sins and placed their faith in Christ. Because nobody has the authority that God has. He's God himself. So he starts to launch. He says, God is the one who justifies. He's the one that makes people right with him through the blood of Jesus, in other words. That we're in right relationship with God because of what God did. Not because of what we did. We responded to what he did with faith. But he's saying that ultimately, God's the one who did this. So nobody's going to bring any kind of condemnation. In verse 34, it says, who's the one who condemns? Well, ultimately, justification and condemnation are in God's hands. He's the one that brings condemnation against those who deny him, those who don't give their life to Christ. So in all of this, he's talking about the comfort of God's sovereignty and that he is in control of everything, that he has absolute power. The middle of verse 34, he said, Jesus Christ is he who died. Yes, rather who was raised. He didn't stay dead, right? That's the gospel, that he died for our sins according to the scriptures, was buried and rose again on the third day. That's how Paul defines the gospel in 1 Corinthians. And so you can see and hear how he's thinking even along those lines here. He says, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. And so not only did Jesus die for us, not only was he raised from the dead and declared and shown to be the Son of God because of that, he ascended to the right hand of the Father, and his role right now is to intercede, to pray for us. In verse 27 of this chapter, the Holy Spirit does the same thing. And so here you have two persons of the Trinity praying for God's people. In fact, the writer of Hebrews mentions it too, speaking of Jesus. It says, therefore, he is able to save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. So if nobody else is praying for you, the Holy Spirit is praying for you, and Jesus is praying for you, and they're perfect, and they're holy, and they're eternal, and they're omniscient, and they're omnipresent, and they're omnipotent because they are God. And as much as I appreciate you guys praying for me, and I appreciate, and I know you appreciate me praying for you, it's a whole lot more important that God Himself is interceding for us, and even within the Trinity, praying for us and bringing up our names and those things that we're going through. So as he mentions that, he then launches into sort of, if this was a sermon, you call it the conclusion or the close. He's really drawing it in. He started sort of, here are my hands. Ooh, you know, he's starting to really come and land the plane, as they say. So he takes off in verse 35. He says, who will separate us from the love of Christ? Now we know the answer to this. The answer is nobody. He's already indicated that in the previous verses, but now he's gonna show us what he means. He says, will tribulation? Well, no, of course it won't. Or distress? No. Or persecution? Certainly not. Persecution draws us closer to him. Or famine? No, that's not going to separate us. I think, you know, we're not going through famine right now, but we're dealing with a virus, and hopefully this time has drawn you closer to the Lord. Or nakedness, so not having those things that you need, you know, those basic needs. Or peril or sword, you know, if you're being threatened, you know, if part of persecution is actual death itself, that will draw you closer to the Lord. It's not going to separate you from him. Verse 36, just as it is written, for your sake we are being put to death all day. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. There's persecution out there in the world, and it does not separate us from God. When a person is killed for their faith, it's not because God has said, you know, I'm done with you and I'm taking you out of here. When a person is killed for their faith, it's an act of witness. It's an act of martyrdom. It's a testimony to the power of God. Verse 37, he says, but in all these things, we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loves us. Now, or loved us. He's speaking specifically of the cross there. So it's an interesting verse. All these things. Well, what things? Well, tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, sword, all those difficulties that we can go through. So in all those things, we overwhelmingly conquer. You guys know, you've probably heard preachers talk about this word for conquer might be on the side of your shoes. It's literally the word Nike. Nike is probably the right way to pronounce it, but we know it as Nike, the shoe brand. It means victory. It means to conquer. And there's an addition to the word. This is a compound word, so that it's translated overwhelmingly conquered. Literally what it says, since we know the word Nike, it literally says hyper Nike. So hyper victory, hyper conquering. We use the word hyper to enhance things as well. So hyper Nike, overwhelmingly conquer. There's victory in knowing him, and there's victory in the fact that our salvation is completed and it's held by God himself, and nothing can separate us from him. Verse 38, he says, for I'm convinced that neither death nor life, so one end of the spectrum or the other, nor angels, so things we can't see, nor principalities, probably demonic, you know, things we can't see as well, but that serve Satan, nor things present, things going on now, nor things to come, so the future, nor powers, maybe also a reference to, could be powers here on earth, it could be spiritual powers, it could, you know, it can go both ways, nor height, nor depth. So see, he's hitting everything. Nor any other created thing. And always smile when I read that. In case he missed something, he says, and anything else. Just if I forgot something, any other created thing. Will be able to separate us from the love of God. Nothing. Now hear me. That means you. You can't separate yourself from the love of God, because it's not up to you to stay connected to the Lord. It's up to him. And he's chosen to stay connected to us because he saved us and given us, you know, the moment you gave your life to Christ, your completed salvation, your glorification was guaranteed. We've seen that all throughout Romans 8. So he says, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. It's all in the fact that Jesus died for us and rose again, and you and I call on the name of the Lord to be saved, and it's through the blood of Christ that we're saved. And in that, absolutely nothing, including ourselves, can separate us from the love of God. So what do we see? What's going on here? What's the final thing? It's real simple. If God has saved us, then he'll keep us saved. If God has saved us, then he will keep us saved. One of the hallmarks of Baptist theology, and it's not just ours, but it's one of the things that people really know about us, is that we believe in once saved, always saved. And I believe that's a very scriptural thing. We've seen it throughout Romans 8. Here's the issue, though. To be always saved, you have to actually be once saved. So walking an aisle doesn't save you. Shaking a preacher's hand doesn't save you. Being baptized doesn't save you. What saves you is placing your faith in Jesus Christ as Lord. You can go through all the outward motions and go through all the things we've created so that you can to show people that you have now become a Christian. But if it's not real, then you and I don't have that guarantee that we won't be separated from the love of God. This is a rock solid guarantee if salvation is genuine. So, a couple things. Number one, our salvation is secure. If you struggle with assurance of salvation, whether or not you're saved or not, that's a different thing. You need to deal with that and ask the Lord to show you and spend time in His Word. But if you know for sure that you're saved, you don't have to worry about losing it. You can't do it because nothing can separate us from the love of God, including ourselves. And then number two, nothing will run God off. So nothing I'm going through, nothing you're going through, nothing that's happening in the world, any of those things is going to cause God to abandon His people. He's not going anywhere, and He's not going to let us go anywhere either. He's not going to let us go. He holds us in His hand, and that holding and that love is something that goes on forever and forever, and that we'll experience personally face to face with Him in eternity. So, what's the wrap up here? Where does Paul land this thing? How does he finish it up? He simply says, if you know Christ, you're always going to know Christ. God's never going to let you go. He's never going to forsake you. You're not going to lose your relationship with Him. Absolutely nothing can separate you from the love of God if you know Him personally. So that's Romans 8 in eight Wednesdays in the Word. I hope you've enjoyed it. I know I have. It's been a great study going through it. Like I said, most likely next week we'll start John 3. That'll take us a few weeks to go through, and so that'll be fun getting into one of the Gospels for a few weeks. Well, guys, I hope the rest of the week goes well. Do remember that this Sunday we'll do our normal Facebook Live broadcast, and then it'll be on the church's YouTube page later. But then the week after that, on the 24th, we will start a meeting on Sunday mornings at 9 o'clock and at 10:30. There'll be more details coming out in the next few days about that. But be in prayer as we work through all the logistics involved in that. So, well, guys, hope everything else goes well. Y'all stay healthy out there. Stay safe. And we'll see y'all online on Sunday.